good evening, Muthi sir.
Hi. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Your hemodynamic talk in question is still I can hear. I was so zapped with that. I was enjoying it. I just came, in fact, I came into that room. We in Natarajan and all just barged in for a few minutes and we sat there for 2 hours.
So we have got 37 participants now. Once we cross, yeah, we got 3 more minutes. 3:57.
Yeah. We'll go before sharp 4.
Yeah, I would request all the participants to keep their mic muted except for the moderator, speaker and the host, please. This is a humble request from us to avoid inconvenience to the speaker and the moderators. Yes. So it's 4 o'clock, so you will start now, sir. Is it okay, sir?
Yeah. Sure, please. Thank you. Hi, good evening. It's a great moment for us. I must first thank all the delegates who have joined in this August gathering. We are now, our entire profession, our learning, our practice, everything has taken a major change in the last few months due to this pandemic. The right word we have been using it is a new normal. And it has affected not only our practice, but also our educational initiatives and the way we learn also. So it occurred to us in our department.
I think Dr. Muralidharan is muted. Can you unmute him?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Sorry, in between there was a problem, sir.
Am I audible? Okay.
Yeah, you are audible now.
Good evening, friends. Good evening, friends. It's my pleasure to invite you all and welcome you all for this great gathering. We are moving into new type of learning process in our educational thing now, with the new normal, the COVID pandemic, our way to approach patients, our way we are going to treat. And not only that, the way we are going to learn and the way we are going to conduct exams, everything has been challenged. And we know we are going to live up to the challenge, we are going to go further. That's why it occurred to us in our department, why don't we have an academic program which makes us prepare not only the students, but the teachers, but the faculty, all of us, to the new normal, to learn, to disseminate our knowledge. And when we thought of this idea, the whole department joined with me. I must thank everyone, particularly Dr. Preetam and my close friends, Dr. Nagendra Bhupati. Both of them made this concept to be a practical one to convert into a teaching program. With this, we thought we'll invite all our friends, the eminent professors all over the country, to join us in this series of lectures, which we are going to have not only this month, but extending to August and even September till the DM or DPNB exam starts. So our main aim is to learn, to teach, and to learn more and more in this new era. With a few words, while thanking everyone, our college, our management, our chancellor, all our department colleagues and my friends, I would like to invite my mentor, my teacher, our former vice chancellor, Professor Jason Murthy, to inaugurate this session by inviting the moderator after his few words about this program. We can go on further. Thank you all. Once again, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Murli. Dear colleagues, on the behalf of Cardiology Department, Sri Ramchandra Institute of Higher Education, it's our proud privilege to welcome our guest speaker, Professor Ramakrishnan, Professor of Cardiology from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and moderator, Professor Ravi Math, Associate Professor, Jayadeva Institute of Sciences and Research, Bangalore. Apart from inviting my own good colleague, Dr. T.R. Muralidharan, and ably helped out by Dr. Bhupati and Dr. Preetam. Our cardiac surgeons and cardiac anesthetists also are joining us for this maiden venture from the Cardiac Care Center of Sri Ramchandra Medical College. Before we start, I would like to introduce the moderator, Professor Ravi Math from the Jayadeva Institute of Medical Sciences. He has a vast experience in teaching and training people in cardiology. We all know that Jayadeva Institute has the largest cardiac training center with more than 20 DM students every year, shows the volume of patients, infrastructure, teaching faculty, research facilities, and all that. It is one of the mentoring institute for many of us in the southern India. Finally, I would like to introduce our speaker, Professor Ramakrishnan. He doesn't require much introduction because many of us know what he is in the academic world. He is a professor of cardiology at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Apart from being a professor, he is also the editor in a journal and a pediatric journal. He is going to talk to us about the rheumatic heart disease clinical evaluation and assessment, which is becoming very, very important to diagnose, evaluate, plan the treatment, and how to go about. It will be helpful for many of us and many of the postgraduate students who are going to take the exams in various streams, maybe DM in various institutions or the National Board of Examinations from the various medical centers. On the behalf of Cardiology Cardiac Care Center of Sri Ramachandra Medical Institute, we welcome you all and particularly thank our speaker, Professor Ramakrishnan and Dr. Ravi Math for being with us and conducting the thing. Dr. Ravi Math, if you want to say.
Nothing much from my side, sir, but thank you very much from the Sri Ramachandra University for inviting me for being the co-moderator. It's very difficult to say any words in front of Dr. Rama. He's my senior at AIIMS and he's been a mentor for many years for both me and Bhupati. He's one of those rare breed of professionals who can navigate both pediatric and adult cardiology with ease. He still runs a pediatric OPD and adult OPD name. So, I mean, hats off to him. So, there's nothing much that we can say in front of Professor Ramakrishnan. I think over to Ramakrishnan, sir.
In addition to his researches, sir. There's no.
Yeah, in addition to research, that is without a given, but.
First to learn more and do research.
Yes. So, to say something in front of him is like showing a candle to the sun. So, let's not waste his time and others' time and let's start over.
So, thank you, sir, Dr. Murthy, for such a kind introduction. Thank you, Dr. Muralidhar. Thank you, Dr. Bhupati, for giving the opportunity. And thank Dr. Ravimath for such a wonderful introduction. I think maybe before we start, can we have a pre-test question? Then we can have a, then we talk, then we have the post questions.
We sincerely request the audience to take the questions. That will help us in assess ourselves and assess your knowledge, how better the educative program has been to improve your knowledge.
So can tell how should they answer the questions like before you start?
Sir, each question will have 20 seconds and after that there will be a poll which will come up where they can answer and those answers will not be revealed till the end.
Sound is not working.
If the sound is not working properly, I would appreciate if the people can have a headphone that increases the connection in the audio video very well. It happens predominantly with the old systems.
So this would be clinical, sir, Rama, sir. Clinical environment. Okay, not echocardiographic.
The 10 questions are over. I now request Dr. Ramakrishna sir to take over.
Yeah, I think, can you stop sharing?
Sir, you can take over, sir. You can directly take over.
I hope my slides are seen.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think initially I was wondering, like, what should I talk about this for maybe around 1.5 hours? 90 minutes is a long time to teach and talk. Then I thought this idea of questioning was very interesting. And I think even though most of you got most of the questions right, but I think there are some issues that need to be sorted out, because some of the issues has to be in the exam. You are supposed to answer all of them 100% correct. That is the biggest problem that happens in the exam. So what are the causes of multivalent heart disease? This, I think, for all practical purposes, only one thing is there. Rest of them are theoretical. So I think mostly it's all rheumatic heart disease only. So most of you will be wondering, like, till the time you pass the exams, you always wonder, like, why should the rheumatic heart disease be there in the exams? Because most of the time we don't see that often in the in practice nowadays, especially in southern parts of the country. And you all wonder, like, why that should be a long case. But there is no escape from a RHD case in any exam, any format, DM, DNB, whatever it is. You just have to accept the challenge. And it is not the fight for your life, but you need to take control in all the things. So why that should be there? Always an RHD case in an exam is an examiner's delight and an examiner's nightmare. But we all know that medicine is an inexact science. Most of the time, there is no... it's not easy. It's not direct. So it's an inexact science. So most of the time you are testing your ability to synthesize things. So which is more important, which is less important, which is to be given more weightage. All those things are beautifully brought out by an RHD case in an examination. So there are various complexities that happen. That is, there is a regurgitation, there is echo versus MRI. We understand that now. Even MRI could be slightly better for assessment than echocardiography even. So valve area by CAT, echo and 3D echo, all are evolving. And even a concept of valve resistance is appearing to be much better than valve area. So there is a new entity of low gradient severe AS. The most important problem in a clinical assessment of an RHD case is all of them we know. The most important problem is there is absolutely no evidence base for whatever we have been teaching for ages and whatever you are expected to tell in the exam for ages. And the most important thing, especially in the DNB setup and the private hospitals, is a lack of exposure to an RHD case. That is also making it more difficult. And I think last but not the least, the most worsening thing is the declining clinical skills. I think where the utility of stethoscope has been put into question, the whole exercise then will be put into question. Why should we have an RHD case and why should we be discussing it in 2020? But still, as a physician, you need to take a lot of things which are in between black and white, and RHD case brings out that to the best of the abilities. So going to a brief set of numbers that you should know and an approach from history, we will be going to the examination and individual lesions by this thing. So how do you approach from history? So what are the frequency with which patients will present to you with rheumatic fever history? What happens in MR and MS? How often you will get a history of rheumatic fever? And what is the latency period from an episode of rheumatic fever? So, for example, in an MR, mostly an MR can happen immediately during an episode of first episode of acute rheumatic fever. And then whereas MS can take generally decades to develop, but we know in our country it can develop very early. Similarly, aortic regurgitations can develop during a first episode also, whereas AS generally takes decades before it manifests. So in terms of manifestation, the more likelihood is MR. If somebody develops initial severe symptoms during an episode of acute rheumatic fever, it is likely to be MR, then next could be AR, then MS is very unlikely, but we do have few patients who just present with episode of acute rheumatic fever with severe MS. AS is almost unlikely. Then onset of symptoms. So you are looking at which conditions can develop early PND versus arthropneia and early CHF. And most importantly, from the onset of symptoms, you are likely to get into which lesion is likely. So most of us, all of us, we almost know that the symptom, there is a long latency period between the development of lesion and symptom onset in mitral regurgitation, for example, all regurgitation lesion. But when the symptoms start, generally they worsen very rapidly. There is not a prolonged phase of gradual progression in symptoms. Whereas the opposite happens in rheumatic mitral stenosis, where generally the symptoms develop early, but they can have a long duration of static course before they tend to worsen with the onset of atrial fibrillation. So all this is very important. So, and then what are the combination of symptoms and what are the specific symptoms that are there and what are the predisposing factors that that are there in the history, so the history you can identify for any clinical worsening. So this is in a nutshell for what you get from history out of a RST lung case. So some specific symptoms, we all know that angina is pretty specific for AS, even though it can have nocturnal angina in AR and very rarely can have a angina in MS also. Syncope is almost puts it at AS. Hemoptysis is generally in MS, and palpitation can be most likely AR, but can be in MR also. And but prominent neck pulsations are, if it is likely to be arterial, they are likely to indicate AR. If they are venous, likely to indicate ER. So coming to the frequency of valve involvement, if you look at isolated valve involvement, 70% to 75% are mitral valve involvement, around 20% to 25% are both, and aortic valve for isolated aortic valve involvement is only 5% to 8%. This is the frequency of valve involvement in a rheumatic fever. So some important numbers that you should know. So what is the frequency of carditis in first episode? It is roughly around 30% to 70%, depending on which hospital you are looking at and which criteria you are looking at, whether you are using echocardiography or whether you are following. So there is a wide variation. So carditis in all attack actually increases to almost 99% if you use echocardiography. Whereas prospective studies, for example, if you have done prospective studies, actually the carditis is not found in all because of the referral bias that is there. So once somebody has rheumatic fever, what is the chance of somebody developing RST on follow-up of around 5 to 10 years? One episode of rheumatic fever, the risk is around 20% to 30%. Whereas one episode of carditis puts it around, so you can remember it like 25% and around 50%. And if there is chorea, it is around 33%. Right? One third of them may develop chorea. If there is a chorea, long-term follow-up, one third can, 20 to 33% can develop RST on follow-up. So what is the chance of somebody having RST? What are the predictors for that if the, during the first episode of rheumatic fever? Clearly, it increases with severity of MR. And if there is presence of congestive heart failure at the time of presentation during an episode of acute rheumatic fever, the chances of getting an RST is pretty certain. So it's very obvious. Like, for example, somebody gets severe MR, that means valve damage is quite severe. Somebody gets heart failure during that episode, that means the valve damage is quite severe. He is likely to have persistent valve involvement at 5 years. So whereas a mild MR or moderate MR are likely to regress. That is what this data says. So the most important prognostic factors are the severity of carditis and obviously recurrences of rheumatic fever once after the first episode of rheumatic fever. So coming to the distribution of RST, what happens to the distribution of RST? So RST almost always means, a multivalve RST almost always means mitral involvement. So this is a beautiful slide that suggests age-wise distribution of pure MS, pure MR and mixed mitral valve disease. So I think this is the very important slide that clearly shows a pure MR is the most predominant lesion in the first 2 decades of life. And the crossover happens somewhere around 25 years of age. Then actually the pure MS as well as mixed mitral valve disease keeps on increasing, whereas pure MR goes down. So I think these things can be useful in some of the discussion that happen. So, like for example, if you look at the way we read for our multivalve disease for our exam and the way we explained in our undergraduate days, postgraduate days and even super specialty days is this almost the same. There is not much data that has come in. I would like to quote a few important studies that all of you should be aware of. This is the EuroHeart survey of all the European data of how often they have multivalve lesions. And this is predominantly not rheumatic. Whereas if you are looking at rheumatic data, this is one of the very good papers from Jayadeva Institute by Dr. Manjuna. So this clearly has almost 1,36,000 and the similar reports are there from Chennai also. So you can look at, I think clearly the multivalve lesions are in one third of patients. This is all more prominently rheumatic. So the predominant lesion form was isolated lesion was MR rheumatic. And then you have multiple valves are involved in one third of patients and MS, MR is more common than MS with AR. So I think this particular article, all of you should go through, because most of the discussion that hinges around various combinations and other things, the article covers it fully. So aortic regurgitation, whenever there is a predominant lesion with mild or moderate MS, this question comes: how often you have its rheumatic, how often is bicuspid. Actually, this is another data that is quite useful, that you can quote, like how often it occurs in combination, and how often it is rheumatic and how often it is bicuspid. All these data are pretty useful. And I told you that the evidence base for the outcomes, evidence base for clinical assessment are pretty much not there in all the valvular heart diseases, except for rheumatic aortic regurgitation, where this Bono's article is quite nice article, which actually is the only data which is available, which clearly says that symptomatic AR over follow-up, how much is the mortality, how much symptoms progress, and how much LV dysfunction progresses. It's around roughly 10% per year mortality of severe symptomatic AR, whereas asymptomatic LV dysfunction develops in around 25% per year. Whereas asymptomatic AR progression to LV dysfunction is around roughly 6% per year. So another important basic information that all of you are aware and all of you should know is the revised Jones criteria. I know most of you know that, but when they are asked, how do you differentiate between low risk population and high risk population, many of you falter. So that I think should be very clear. What are the new changes that has happened to this criteria? How do you diagnose recurrences with this criteria? And why these changes have happened? How do you differentiate between a low risk and a high risk population? All these things you should know. So because this is based on the incident, low risk population or high risk population is dependent on the incidence of acute traumatic fever. You should know the acute traumatic fever incidence in the country. There are very, very limited studies that actually looked at the incidence of acute traumatic fever in the population at risk. So there is only one study that is 2014 that's published that says annual incidence of around 8.7 per 1 lakh population. So I think this kind of a data you should know. So this I told you, like how do you differentiate moderate and high risk, what are the differences that are there. I think all of you should be aware. So some of the other key information that essential information. Hello? Hello?
Go ahead. I think it's
sorry, about okay.
So some of the other important numbers that can be summarized here are like what happens with sore throat. Like you have roughly around 4 to 6 attack per year, and generally up to the age of 10 years, sore throats are more common. Out of which 1.5 to 19% are supposed to be streptococcal. That is, you can remember like 2 to 20% are streptococcal, and 50% are asymptomatic, and 25% carrier states are also there. And out of which roughly 0.3 to 3%, depending on endemicity and epidemic features, then they develop acute rheumatic fever, out of which around 20 to 30% end up developing RSG. This is a rough flow chart that all of you should be aware. If you know more details, you are most welcome, but I think this is a rough number that you should all know. I think unlike the current era students, I think the acute rheumatic fever is a old disease, and it actually remains fairly obedient. And it actually follows some rules which are very strict, and generally it follows. So early carditis, that is 80% within first 2 weeks of illness. The nodules generally means carditis. And endocardium is pretty central. Pericarditis and heart failure never occur without valvular involvement. And it is generally self-limiting, around 8 to 12 weeks in 95% of people. And arthritis is generally non-deforming and has typical joint involvement. And generally recurrences beget recurrences. And there is mimetic carditis, that means whatever is the first episode, generally then recurrent episodes is mimic like the first episode. And there are some exceptions to the rule. One is an indolent carditis, which we don't know, which we don't understand. For how long it can continue, we don't know. And then inapparent and silent carditis. And at times it can actually form a deforming arthritis called Jacquard's arthritis. So another related term that all of you should know is the post-streptococcal reactive arthritis. It has a short latent period of 3 days to 2 weeks. It is non-migratory arthritis. It's a large and small joints with axial skeleton is involved in around 20% of people. And morning stiffness is generally present. It's almost mimics something like a reactive arthritis. Most of you would have seen reactive arthritis patients in your MD days. And then it really responds poorly to aspirin and NSAIDs. But it persists for a more time. Generally, it can last up to 8 months. And the mean is around 2 months comparative to acute rheumatic fever, which is generally short lasting. And it can lead to permanent joint damage. So the most important thing is 6% of them ultimately end up developing mitral valve disease. So we really don't know whether it is to be considered as a separate entity or a variation in presentation of post-streptococcal syndromes. We don't know. So all of you should be aware of the various other streptococcal syndrome like PANDAS and other things. You should be aware if you are asked about. So another important data that you should know about is the regression of disease. So unfortunately, echocardiographic data based regression studies are not ongoing now. These are the old data that are available. I think they are clearly documented regression to the tune of 33% to 66%, depending on the way it is assessed. Most of them are not echocardiographic studies. I think if you follow echocardiographic studies, it's more towards 2/3 generally regress if you follow asymptomatic mild patients with mild MR and all so on. So another important paper that all of you should read before going into any final examination will be this REMEDY study, which is actually a lot of Indian centers and African centers participated, which is the current era statistics of all rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart disease, what happens in them. Like, for example, you are commonly asked how often you have acute rheumatic fever history in RST. This is clearly given here. It is 40.7%. 33% will present to you with the congestive heart failure at presentation. Stroke happens in 7.1%. So all these data are there. Infective endocarditis risk is 4% per year. So all these data are there. There is a current registry which is, I think, recently published. So there are a lot of data in this. When you are asked, you can quote a lot of data from this, as current as it can get. So coming to the clinical part, now I have given some food for reading and some food for thought. Now we go to what are we presenting? What are we dealing and what are we presenting? So suppose if I present the final diagnosis, as we start from the diagnosis first. So this is the final diagnosis I'm going to present. RST, severe MS, moderate MR, severe AR, in congestive heart failure, normal sinus rhythm, NOHA functional class 3, no evidence of rheumatic fever or infective endocarditis. So what else is missing in this diagnosis? Any volunteers? What else is missing in this diagnosis? Like, what else you should give in a final long case? Like, any volunteers? Anybody wants to answer? This is a common garden final diagnosis that give you always give in your exam.
Okay, some are answering. I think
can you read them out the chat?
Yeah. So PVH and PH is what they have mentioned.
Yeah.
And LV function is another answer.
Yeah. So I think these are the ones that are missing. That you are right. PVH, PH, LV function, and any precipitating factors like anemia or anything else is there. That is what is missing in the diagnosis. So in nutshell, you always remember that you are supposed to give all these 9 features that are there. Like, for example, you have a severity and combination of lesion that always you will not miss. And then at times you often miss, like when there's a third lesion, you will just at times miss indicating the severity when the examiner has to ask what is the severity. You should not miss anything. NHA functional class and heart failure has to be there. Then rhythm, pulmonary venous hypertension, pulmonary arterial hypertension, every function, features of carditis, features of infective endocarditis, and what are the precipitating factors. All these 9 features should be there. Mm-hmm. And one important thing that you should always do is you should always match whatever you have written in terms of combination and severity in PBH and PH with the clinical feature that you have made. You just have to see 9 things. 9 things you have to see. 3 things in general examination, 3 things before auscultation, and 3 things in auscultation. Everything should be matching with whatever diagnosis you have given. And that exercise you should always do before you pin down your final diagnosis. So the 3 important things are the pulse, the blood pressure, and the JVP. Oftentimes you will say that patient is in congestive heart failure, you will describe JVP as normal. And you will not describe a hepatomegaly when there is gross heart failure. You will be saying patient is in class 4 and is in gross heart failure. So all these errors can be minimized. You will say severe TR, you will explain the JVP as no V wave. So, and you will explain a predominant AS as your final diagnosis. You will say a rapid rising and a collapsing pulse. So all these mistakes every one of us have made. I think it's about exercise, doing a exercise before each individual final diagnosis. You should correlate with all the 9 features. In the general examination, 3 features, these are the 3. And then apical impulse, parasternal heave, and thrills. And always make sure that everything correlates with whatever you are saying and whatever you have written as your final diagnosis. So that's very important. So a brief thing about heart sounds, because most of you stumble in when you're asked about heart sound. So what is the capacity of human ear? It is 18,000 hertz. We can appreciate something which is 20 millisecond apart. So most of the cardiovascular sounds are in the lower range, that is 32,000. Because at 18,000 hertz is dependent on the age, we actually lose higher frequency hearing ability over time. So I think fortunately for the elderly examiners, most of the mammals fall in the ever audible range of human beings. So the three characteristics that you should always look at is the loudness of the sound, the pitch of the sound, and the quality of the sound. The high frequency sounds are related to the opening snap and the ejection sounds, the closure sounds like S1 and S2. Whereas low frequency sounds like the early diastolic filling, the late diastolic filling events of the ventricle, they are all low frequency sound. This is a very, very nice diagram. Whatever I have told you is actually in a pictorial format, so that this picture you can remember for quite some time. Right? So most of the heart sounds lie in the left extreme. So how do you differentiate between a low pitch sound, a low pitch murmur, a high pitch murmur, and a medium pitch? All those things depend on this important one. The 25 to 125 is a low pitch where actually the flow is increased, the pressure gradient is down. So generally you get a rumbling murmur like mitral stenosis. A medium pitch like this around, both are increased. Like for example, the pressure gradient is high, then the flow is also high. So you have a harsh murmurs like aortic stenosis, whereas a high is above 300. So anything 25 to 125 is a low pitch sound, whereas above 300 is a high pitch sound. So this is another thing that all of you should know before going to any examination, is the basic physiology. Where each of the murmur appear and where, what is the shape of the murmur. So always start practicing this. Always you should be able to draw a ECG. You should be able to draw a JVP line according to the ECG, and you should be able to draw the murmur and always know this physiology, because every time you will be wondering why oftentimes the examiner asks you what is the difference between an early systolic murmur and an ejection systolic murmur. This you will find almost always invariably asked when a pan-systolic murmur starts and when a ejection systolic murmur starts. That is because we want to know whether you know the concept that aortic valve, when it opens, then only ejection systolic murmur can start appearing. Whereas a pan-systolic murmur will start to appear whenever there is a ventricle starts to contract. So MR and TR, all of them appear in the isometric relaxation phase. Whether you know all this is the primary fundamental thing why all these questions are asked. This is fundamental basic physiology. So let me tell you how the examination or how the final case analysis differences between an undergraduate and a postgraduate and a super specialty. The case remained the same. The way you present remain the same. The only two things that differentiate a DM exam from an undergraduate and a postgraduate exam is your ability to understand and discern the natural history of the disease and ability to understand the pathophysiology and the hemodynamics behind a particular condition. So essentially, we are actually looking at whether you understand the physiology, understand the hemodynamics, you know something about the natural history of the particular disease. This is exactly what we want to know from whatever you know from your MD days and from your MBBS days. Even if you present an MSAR, the way you would have presented would have been the same. So this is a fundamental thing that you should all know. So coming to individual lesions, how do you assess the severity of MS? So we all know that prolonged diastolic murmur should be there. Presence of a thrill in MS generally considered as an indicator of severity. A A2-OS gap, which we will discuss in detail. Presence of pulmonary hypertension, cardiomegaly, and congestive heart failure, if they are isolated severe mitral stenosis is producing all of them. Presence of AS, intensity of murmur, and pre-systolic accentuation alone do not correlate with severity of mitral stenosis. Whereas the whole length of the diastolic murmur is correlating with the severity of thing. So whenever you need to understand, you are all younger generation. You are all learning cardiology from echocardiography lab more than clinical stethoscope and auscultation. You always think of whenever you are asked about describe a murmur, describe how the murmur will be in mild and moderate. Always immediately think how your echo Doppler picture will be. So whatever you are seeing in the Doppler picture is what you are supposed to auscultate. So how the mild MS will be there in Doppler and how the severe MS will be there in Doppler. So this is what you have to understand. And same what will happen in AF. So if you always remember and read everything clinically with a focus on what you see in echocardiography day lab day in and day out, things are much easier. But in a presence of a multivalve heart disease where multiple valves are involved with varying severity, so what are the things that will stand out? permanent hypertension, cardiomegaly, and heart failure can be because of other lesions also. A prolonged diastolic murmur and a thrill and A2S gap, with some exceptions, will actually hold true. So coming to A2S, the opening snap, so this is another commonly asked question. So once I put such tables, everybody, my examiners and my teachers tell me that you oversimplify things and you give a lot of spoon feeding. But I think it's fair, like once you have some reference to look back upon and read about all this, I think it's important. So how do you differentiate between A2OS and then A2P2? So A2P2 is obviously closer and it will widen during inspiration, whereas this will be narrowing with the inspiration. And most importantly, opening snap. So most of you are Tamilians, I can tell that I was fortunate to do my MBBS in Madurai. So I had the luxury of reading under my medicine teachers were G. Vijayarangan, Alagappan, Challaya, Rangarajan. All of them are extraordinary clinical teachers. So some of them, I don't know who told this. So he said, opening snap, oralang kekum. So it's heard everywhere. So I think that is something that these kind of things will always remember. So it's generally heard everywhere. Then it's better heard between the apex and the left sternal border. Whereas A2P2 is obviously heard in the pulmonary area. So how do you differentiate between opening snap and S3? Same. It is a localized sound. S3 is at the apex. It's a low pitch sound. Whereas opening snap is a high pitch sound. And the intervals you should know. And the postural variation generally S3 doesn't change. Whereas it can widen on standing. So another thing here, even though it is not related to the multivalve heart disease, this is some diagram that you should know with the relative timing of each of these sounds, like when do each diastolic sound happen and what. So this is something that all of you should be aware of, at what intervals each time sounds happen. So coming back to A2OS gap, so we all know that this is inversely proportional to severity. It's generally 40 to 120 milliseconds. So generally, how do you hear what? Some of you may not be aware how to make out this different distinction because you have not auscultated many hearts with severe and mild MS or post-PTMCs. So best way to identify if your center is doing PTMC, always listen to the patient if there's an opening snap before PTMC and after PTMC. You can easily make out over time the exact difference that happens with the A2OS gap over time. So, but it's not a straightforward thing. It depends on the heart rate, it depends on the LA pressure, it depends on LVEDP, it depends on LV compliance and the mobility of the valve. So narrow always indicates it's tight MS. Whereas it can be falsely widened in the presence of severe MS due to bradycardia, AR, low output or any condition that increases LVEDP. So this is, if you have the background list, I think you can extrapolate most of them here. What will be the effect of each of these conditions on A2OS interval? So it can actually, anything that increases LVED, anything that increases will increase the A2OS, it will falsely widen the A2OS gap. So systemic hypertension, aortic stenosis, so all of them will, LV dysfunction, bradycardia, so all of them will worsen. So what happens in AF, A2OS gap in AF? So if the preceding cycle length is short, the LA pressures will be high. This is very clear, the preceding length is short, the LA pressures will be high. So atrial interval will be short for the subsequent cycle. So this is something that is called the Wells index, which is supposed to be a constant index. I think nowadays nobody is asking that, but it's an index that can be calculated by phonocardiograms like Q to S1, that is Q to M1 minus A2OS interval is called the Wells length, and that remains constant for each cycle length of AF. So murmur of AMS, I think you know, how do you describe it? It's a mid-diastolic, low pitch, rough rumbling, decreased systolic oxygen without it, best heard over the apex with the bellows of the stethoscope in the left heart position with the breath held in expiration. This is a total description of murmur of MS. There are two components. The early diastolic component that begins with just after the opening snap and corresponds to the rapid filling phase of the diastole, and then late diastolic or the pre-systolic murmur that follows left atrial contraction and represents sudden increase in transmittal flow and velocity prior to the valve closure. So these are the two components. Why do they have? And can they have a generally pre-systolic accentuation will not be there in atrial fibrillation because the atrial pump booster pump in effect is not there, but it can be there in some patients. Why it can be there, you should go and refer. So what are the factors that increase the intensity of diastolic rumble in MS? This is common finding that you find you think that is MS, but you can't find a good murmur. You make the patient exercise and you bring out the murmur, then this kind of question will come. So most of the reason is for you to have a murmur, there has to be a gradient and there has to be a flow. and whatever sound is produced, you should be able to auscultate with your stethoscope. So in between area has to be cleared. So this is how you should think. So whenever the flow is low, like severe MS, critical MS, severe PH, or heart failure, AF with fast ventricular rate, you may not hear a good loud murmur. So features of mitral valve, the valve is not able to, valve apparatus is not able to produce the sound, that is extensive calcification, subvalvar caudal obliteration, epithelial thrombus protruding into the mitral artery, which is extremely rare, and the posterior medial deviation of the mitral orifice, all of them actually can produce a softer lumbar. If there are associated lesions also can sometimes, mainly PH with RV dilatation, where apex is formed by RV is the most commonly encountered reason for silent MS. And then obviously inability like obesity and COPD always can. Coming to one important thing that is repeatedly asked in the exams is about juvenile MS, which is one important contribution of all India Institute and generally cardiology to the whole field of cardiology. So severe MS at an early age, below 20 years of age, generally it is a rapid progression of stenosis. There is extensive thickening of the mitral valve with severe subvalvular deformity, but generally no calcification, no atrial fibrillation, and thromboembolism is rare. So these are the three things that are there, not there. Calcification, atrial fibrillation, and thromboembolism. Because atrial fibrillation, thromboembolism are generally indicator of age of the patient. Like they are more related to the age of the patient than to severity of mitral stenosis. So, for example, a moderate MS patient can have atrial fibrillation compared to a severe MS patient at 18 years of age. The chance of moderate MS at 40 years having atrial fibrillation will be higher than the chance of 16-year or 18-year-old AF patient having AF. And they have a lot of severe pulmonary hypertension and suprasystemic pulmonary artery pressures are quite common. Generally, less than 12 years are actually worse off due to malignant nature of the disease in developing countries. So moving on to MR. So how do you identify MR is severe? So obviously, apical dilatation, cardiomegaly, presence of LV S3 and diastolic flow murmur, wide split S2, presence of a thrill. Some textbooks tried to presence of a thrill in MR as an indicator of severity. Most of the senior physicians, senior cardiologists, the clinical era cardiologists generally don't accept this because many of us have seen moderate MR also patient having thrill when it is anteriorly directed jet in rheumatic heart disease. And the presence of LV dysfunction, pulmonary hypertension, even though they are rare late features, they are isolated MR, they can indicate severe MR. So, but in the presence of multivalve heart disease, suppose a patient has AR or AS or mitral stenosis, so cardiomegaly can be because of other lesion. So you can have LVS3 or a diastolic murmur because of an ostentorian murmur or because of an MS murmur, or there can be LVS3 because of aortic regurgitation or because of aortic stenosis with LV dysfunction, there can be LVS3. So LV dysfunction, pulmonary hypertension, congestive heart failure can be because of various other valve lesions. So the only finding that generally tends to stay, if it is there, is a wide split S2. In a multivalve heart disease, if you find no finding is giving us a clue because there is already severe AR is there, or already a severe AS with LV dysfunction is there, if you find S3, it can't say that MR is severe. So the diastolic murmur can be an ostentorian murmur. So the only clue generally available in a multivalve heart disease where other valves are severe is a wide split S2. So coming to severe AR, so you have a Hill sign, the duration of diastolic murmur, ostentorian murmur, thrill is extremely rare, cardiomegaly, LVS3, LV dysfunction, pulmonary hypertension, and congestive heart failure are actually pre-terminal events. So in a multivalve heart disease, actually the Hill sign, the duration of diastolic murmur and the ostentorian murmur can remain. So Hill sign, a brief about Hill sign. We all know how do you classify Hill sign, but we also know that maybe it's falsely low in LV dysfunction, acute AR and associated AS. But this is the only condition where actually people have looked at the evidence based for the modern era type sensitivity specificity of the clinical signs. So actually, if you look at these signs, actually don't stand anywhere. It's quite, the sensitivity and specificity are not so great. Whereas the Corrigan sign is quite sensitive for a moderate to severe AR, whereas it's not so specific. That's the problem that happens. So the signs are actually, if you look at individually, apart from Hill sign, actually is quite specific or sensitive. So another important thing that has come up of late is is it a fact or an artifact? So clearly now the internet measurement using intraarterial probe do not show the pressure difference. So actually, the even though there are mechanisms described, but possibly it could be a pseudo sign. So it could be become a sphygmomanometer artifact because of the way we measure the blood pressure. But still, I would say clinically, it's still a useful sign, even though with the understanding that it could be falsely low in LV dysfunction, acute AR if there is associated AS. So we know that it may be an artifact, but still, I think it could be useful in clinical setting the way we use it. So coming to heart sound in AR, so it can be normal or decreased depending on the etiology of S1. Then S2 is variable. It can be accentuated in syphilitic aortitis or aortic root diseases. Split S2 is absent singular narrow paradoxical split due to inaudible A2 or A2 moving to due to P2 due to prolonged LV ejection time, where P2 may be lost in the prominent diastolic movement. So S3 is not in mild or moderate AR. In severe AR, it's due to increase in LV diastolic blood volume. S4 is a rare finding suggestive of LV stiffness. And then ejection click is a valve or root origin generally is indicated. So you know how to describe the murmur of AR. Then you have specific situations like you can have a Cobian type of murmur. You have it because of a resonating, vibrating, loud diastolic murmur, generally because of a tissue vibrations between the jet, jet. So that means it's generally found in perforation or rupture of aortic cusp. So AR murmur on the right side of the sternum, when you have an aortic aneurysm because of cystic medial necrosis, syphilis or idiopathic, you have sinus of Valsalva aneurysm, or you have aortic dissection or selective perforation or eversion of the right coronary cusp, all these situations you will have an AR murmur that is better appreciated on the right side of the sternum. Coming to Austin Flynn murmur, because in a multivalve heart disease, always this diastolic murmur at the mantle valve creates a lot of confusion for the students and a lot of delay for the examiners, because there are a lot of questions that can be asked on the diastolic murmur, whether there is MS or not, whether it is a murmur is due to MS or whether it's a flow murmur, if there's a murmur due to MR murmur or not, all those things can be asked. Just a low pitch rumbling apical diastolic murmur indicates a rheumatic. So generally associated with peripheral signs of AR, correlates with severity and suggestive of increased LV EDP. So I think you can read about the mechanisms coming back to severe AS. So severe AS is clinically diagnosed by pulsus parvus head tardus, peaking of the systolic murmur, paradoxically split S2, LV S4, apical carotid delay which is often neglected in the clinical examination, presence of a thrill, cardiomegaly, LV S3, pulmonary hypertension, congestive heart failure are pretty rare signs. If you look at the in a multivalve heart disease, these are the lot of things still stand for severe AS, unlike severe MR where almost everything disappears. In a multivalve heart disease, many of them still stand true. So things that stand in a multivalve heart disease are very simple. They are the pulse and the Hill sign in aortic valve disease, the murmur characteristics except in severe MR, the diastolic thrills generally stand, and S2, paradoxical split S2 in AS and wide split S2 in MR generally indicate, when they are there, indicate presence of severity in these lesions, being there in the presence of a multivalve heart disease. And A2 OS gap, most of the time in a multivalve heart disease, indicates severity of MS. So some of the rules of combined valvular lesions. So severe lesions tend to dominate. The proximal lesions tend to dominate, like for example, tricuspid stenosis tend to protect or mask the mitral valve and the aortic valve lesions. And there is a tremendous ability for compensation. So in a multivalve heart disease, 1+1 may not be 2. So some of the questions that are commonly found at the end of all this discussion, once you understand the individual lesion, is how do you assess when there are multiple lesions there, which one is severe? First, look at the valve, like if there is severe MR, is there MSS there or not? So how do you identify if there is MSS there or not, if there is an MDM? So presence of a diastolic thrill, a prolonged MDM, opening snap, loud S1 and severe PH tend to indicate there is severe MS. So these are the ways when you have a combined lesion, when there is an MS or MR, how do you differentiate which one is more severe? So either it is the diastolic murmur is generally prolonged with thrill, then you consider MS to be severe. If it's a RV apex with tapping character, or if it's an LV apex with hyperkinetic, you think of severe MR. Opening snap versus S3. So if the presence of severe S3 almost rules out severe MS. So generally, PH is more severe in severe MR, sorry, severe MS, whereas MR can produce in acutely or subacutely severe PH can be found, or it can be found in pretty late situations. So another common question that is comes up is when you have a severe AR patient and you have a ejection systolic murmur at the aortic area. This is a common scenario that almost every other case you will have. So how do you differentiate whether there is severe AS is there or not? How is the pulse? How is the rate of rise of pulse? Oftentimes in a description, you will not worry about the rate of rise of pulse. That should be there. And whether there is systolic decapitation is there or not. And whether it's a late peaking murmur or a, what is the character of the murmur? So in my short period as examiner, I've gone for examiner for DM, DNB. Most of the time in an ejection systolic murmur, the students don't describe the peaking of the murmur. They describe everything else. They will describe what happens to hand grip, what happens to this, what happens to that. But they generally forget about peaking. So this is something that is very important in an ejection systolic murmur that you should always come out with. And presence of a heaving apical impulse and presence of a thrill generally indicates association of organic AS rather than a flow murmur of ejection systolic murmur. In a presence of a combined lesion, AS and AR, how do you assess severity of the lesion? Which one is more severe? So it again depends on the pulse. So always aortic lesion means pulse. The most important clue will be there in the pulse. So how is the rate of rise? How is the upstroke? Whether the collapsing pulse is there or not? Hill sign is there or not? And what is the apical impulse? Generally in a severe AS, you are likely to find a heaving apical impulse, which is normally located. Whereas AR, it will be hyperkinetic, it's a LV type of apex, it's a dilated apex. So additional sounds, S3 is rare, S4 is quite common, whereas AR, S3 is reasonably commonly found in severe AR. Murmur is a late peaking murmur, whereas it's a long EDM will be there if it's a severe AR. And S2 is paradoxical or normal or narrow split will be there. So then we move on to the combination lesions between the valves. Like for example, if there is AS with MR. So what happens, because these are all common questions that are asked, you should have a hemodynamic understanding of how each lesion affects the other one. That's a very important thing at this level. So MR in general overestimate the LV ejection fraction, masking the LV systolic function caused by AS. And whereas severe AS worsens the degree of MR, that we know. Because a high intraventricular pressure may result in high RV, whereas ERO is less affected. So basically, AS and MR is a terrible combination that can be had in terms of very little forward output going. So pathophysiological interaction between aortic stenosis and mitral regurgitation is both of them actually adversely, the aortic stenosis adversely impact the LV remodeling and the LV pressure and actually increases mitral regurgitation. So which is quite obvious. That decreases the functional tolerance, early appearance of aortic regurgitation, decreases the forward output, but still it may temporarily increase ejection fraction, but at the same time, it actually will produce a diagnostic challenge. So coming to the clinical finding of the effect of MR and AS and the AS on MR. So what is the effect of MR and AS? So let us just think over it, like don't read this, just think over it. What will be the effect MR will have on AS? It will have further delayed carotid upstroke, increased LV ejection time may be normalized, apical impulse may be diffuse as well as sustained. So P2 may be associated, be loud if there is associated with PH. Early A2 because of MR may mask paradoxical split. S3 is likely if significant MR is there, and prominent S4 is unlikely if there is significant MR. What will happen to the reverse? What is the effect of AS on MR? So apex is more sustained than expected. The systolic murmur of MR may be accentuated. S3 if significant LV dysfunction is there. So what happens with the combination of AS and MS? AS will increase the LV ADP. It will attenuate the transmitral gradient. So it will abbreviate the MDM. Whereas AS will increase the LV ejection time. It can lengthen the A2OS gap and it can shorten the MDM. So due to raised AVP and LA pressure may further be elevated during the aggravation of symptoms of pulmonary venous hypertension may be worsened. And AS may aggravate the symptom of MS while masking some of the physical findings. However, the reverse is usually more common. MS generally attenuates the physical finding of aortic stenosis. That is much more common. So what is the effect of significant MS on aortic stenosis? So the flow across the aortic valve is decreased. So no cardiac output state is further worsened, and it actually decreases the clinical finding of aortic stenosis. So there can be a less delayed carotid upstroke, less intense ejection systolic murmur. So EPEX generally is well sustained, less well sustained. So S4 is absent if there is MS is significant. So when you start getting some of the characteristic finding of AS, even though the murmur and the pulse doesn't suggest, then always suspect associated severe AS. So it's fairly more common than whatever we have discussed. Apart from MS and MR, the second most common combination is MS with AR. So MS, most of the patients will have some degree of AR, though often not very significant. So MS and AR generate opposite loading conditions. Hyperdynamic LV contractility and LV enlargement will be less evidence in presence of MS. Usually symptoms of MS generally predominate if there is MS with AR. If a patient with the obvious clinical signs of AR presents with early dyspnea, pulmonary edema, hemoptysis or systemic embolism, always suspect mantle stenosis. Like pulmonary hypertension as AF also, always suspect mantle stenosis in the presence of AR. So severe MS, if it is extremely critical, then may mask wide pulse pressure or other associated signs of diastolic runoff. On the other hand, wide pulse pressure and more hyperdynamic effects than expected in isolated MS would give a clue about associated AR. In severe AR, by increasing LV diastolic pressure, attenuate the transmantle gradient and mask some of the findings of MS. AR murmur versus Gram-Steele murmur, that's a common question that is asked. So how do you differentiate between an AR murmur and a Gram-Steele murmur because of pulmonary hypertension? So you can get a help of hand grip and squatting. How do you differentiate between AR and which is predominant? If you find that there is MS and there is AR, how do you differentiate with that which is more dominant? So obviously it depends on the pulmonary symptoms, systemic embolization, the wide pulse pressure, the parasternal lift and the prominent apical impulse, and then LVS3 is there or not. So another common question that comes up is how to differentiate between the mitral stenosis murmur and the Austin Flynn murmur. So this is a very common question that comes up. So you can have MS will have prolonged murmur with a thrill, whereas Austin Flynn is generally a soft and a shorter murmur. Apex will be RV and tapping like a severe MS, whereas in the presence of an Austin Flynn, it should be an LV and hyperkinetic. Added sounds will be opening snap here and LVS3 there. PH is generally severe mitral stenosis, whereas generally mild at best. S1 is mostly loud. AF is suggestive and hand grip tends to differentiate between MS and Austin Flynn. So coming to the last of the major combinations, the left side, so the AR and MR. So mostly this is one combination where you should put up a lot of differential diagnosis, like where other things are possible, like connective tissue disease, secondary involvement in bicuspid aortic valve is also possible. IE or previously diseased valve is also possible. So both of the lesions tend to produce LV volume overload, decrease the impedance to LV emptying, decrease valve tension, increase ejection fraction. Hence, EF may be an unreliable indicator of LV function. So when the MR dominate, mild to moderate MR is generally well tolerated. Significant MR in the presence of AR generally is poorly tolerated. More LV dysfunction and rapid worsening of LV dysfunction and worse surgical results start to happen. The competent mitral valve protects LA and pulmonary vein from the effects of acute AR. The backward effects of AR may be augmented by diastolic MR. So AR can worsen MR by LV dilatation. So coming to clinical findings between MR and AR, symptoms may not help in differentiation. Pulmonary hypertension may appear earlier because of the combination. Both lesions can cause a brisk carotid upstroke, evidence of LV enlargement, LVS3. So, and then the most important point that you should know that the differentiation between LVS3 as an indicator of dysfunction in MR versus AR. That's a distinction that you should be aware of. And apical diastolic murmur can be produced by both the lesions. The presence of S4 indicate dominant AR or relative recent onset of MR. So the presence of atrial fibrillation, pulmonary hypertension generally indicate significant MR. The murmur of MR is generally accentuated, AR murmur is generally unaltered, and the severity of MR is difficult to assess in the presence of AR. That's what I was repeatedly finding out. The only thing that will help in the presence of severe AR will be not cardiomegaly, not S3, but widespread S2. So clinical clues for assessment will be if the presence of severe AR will be severe PVH or PH, atrial fibrillation, evidence of LA enlargement, you should suspect severe MR. So this is some of the caveats that are there given in this beautiful article. This is almost echo, like because you guys can actually relate to ECHO much more than all these hemodynamics easily. I think you should read this article thoroughly, because this actually summarizes the whole thing very easily. In an ECHO knowledgeable people very easily can understand this, which actually you can go back and implement this when you are asked about clinical questions in hemodynamics. So this is a very useful article that clearly summarizes all the interaction between various valuations. So coming to tricuspid valuations, so tricuspid valve easily escapes detection. It causes more fatigue and heart failure. It produces less PND and arthropneia. JVP is the key. Always tricuspid valve is JVP. So giant A waves and slow wide descent can be there, but most often than not, you will have atrial fibrillation. You should have pulsatile liver, and the moment of TS, how to differentiate between AMS will be location, whether it is pre-systolic, mid-diastolic, and inspiratory augmentation. When you are in a multivalve heart disease, the most common confusion that happens is whether it is an organic TR or is a high pressure TR because of secondary TR. So organic TR is generally it's a low pressure TR, so it can be early systolic with variable duration, whereas the murmur will be pan systolic if it's a high pressure TR. Most often than not, you will find a high pressure TR in all clinical scenarios. The pitch will be a high pitch, whereas the low pressure TR will be low pitch. The shape will be a pan systolic murmur, which will be a decrescent of murmur in a low pressure TR. So you will have other signs like CV waves will be there, and the P2 will be loud. Low pressure TR, JVP appearance will be variable depending on the etiology. So because severe PH and PVH, you should be able to classify. You should know how to classify it based on the pressures. So how do you classify in children also, you should know. How do you classify PH and how do you classify PVH? So what are the signs of PH? What are the signs that you are looking at? So left pastoral heave is a very important sign of PH. When it is not a sign of PH, you should know. Loud P2 or palpable P2, that's a very, very important sign based on which we assess clinical assessment of PH is made. Whether it is comparable to A2, whether it is palpable. So whether it is louder than A2 means clearly it is loud. It's loud, there is severe PH. But it is palpable P2 is loud in the absence of a shunt lesion like an ASD. ASD, you can have a palpable P2 in the absence of severe PH. But rest of the condition, generally you have severe PH, palpable P2 means generally it is severe PH. And then there's a beautiful study, a small study that has suggested that where you are able to hear P2, generally correlates with the level of P2, level of PH, systolic pressure of pulmonary artery pressures. So for example, if you're able to hear at the apex, generally the PA pressures are greater than 80. That is what the people have written. It's a continuum that starts from the pulmonary area, it extends to the apex. So various numbers are given. The presence of RV, S3 and S4, ejection click, which is a constant click of severe PH, the murmur of TR, ejection systolic murmur and murmur of PR, the Gram-Still murmur, all signs of severe PH. Similarly, you may be asked to differentiate between low pressure PR and a high pressure PR. Same way, the pitch is going to be high in a high pressure, low in a low pressure PR. The murmur is a longer duration murmur, whereas a low pressure PR will be a brief decrease of the murmur. The other signs will be there, palpable P2 and loud, and the loud and variable narrow split P2 will be there. So how do you assess PVH in a multivalve lesion? Even though we always ask you to assess, many of the times there is no clarity. How do you assess PVH? So PVH is assessed based on the symptom class of the individual, the history of pulmonary edema, presence of pulmonary edema, then cardiomegaly, and a rough estimate from RA pressure estimation. I will come back once I told you how to assess hemodynamics from cardiac clinical examination, and from PA pressure estimation. So I will come back to both these points, why not to make these mistakes. So the most important clinical clues are symptom class, pulmonary edema, presence or absence of pulmonary edema, and cardiomegaly. Whereas PND is not class 4, class 2 patient also can have PND. Generally, arthropneia is considered as a significant class 4 symptom. So coming to atrial fibrillation, it significantly modifies clinical findings. S1 is variable, and the diastolic event assessment, actually you all have to know, MS and AR assessment. Most of you measure oscillometric methods for blood pressure measurement in today's time. How should you measure blood pressure in atrial fibrillation? That alone is a separate topic for discussion. Are the automated instruments good enough in atrial fibrillation? Because this I would like all my DM students and DMD students to know, because atrial fibrillation is becoming so common disease, not in valve, in the context of aortic heart disease, isolated low AF is so common, and hypertension is one of the most important risk factors. So we should be very clear and thorough about how to measure blood pressure in AF and whether automated instruments are good enough for this. So another important thing is, even though we expect you to assess LV function. It is one of the most difficult things to assess in a multivalve heart lesion. I think oftentimes it can be erroneous. It can be lot of judgments has to be made. I think if you don't say in a particular case that I am not able to assess, it's fine. But you should know why you cannot say. But there are some very, very few limited clues that are available. So S3 does not always mean LV function, LV dysfunction, especially in the presence of MR. So Bisperian means a normal LV function. The presence of a Bisperian pulse always means normal LV function. So the two important clues that will give about LV function is a sustained apex in the presence of a volume overload. If you have a dilated apex and the apex is suddenly now looking like hyperdynamics as well as it's getting sustained, then you think of a volume overload condition becoming LV dysfunction, where LV dysfunction is setting in. Whereas you have a dilated apex and a diffuse apex in the presence of a pressure overload, you should always think of, for example, your clinical diagnosis is severe AS, but you find the apex which is dilated down and out, which is dilated and diffuse, you should think of, even though it's heaving, but it is dilated and diffuse apex, you should always think of LV systolic dysfunction. Rarely you can find the real apex having the different pulsations because of akinesia. They are very uncommon. So there are very few clues actually with which you can assess LV function in the presence of multivalve heart disease. So I mean heart failure. Most of the time, rheumatic heart disease in general develops, left heart symptoms develop. There is a latency period where pulmonary hypertension develops. The RV is able to hold on for quite some time. When the RV stops to hold on, then the patient develops congestive heart failure. This is the paradigm that works. But rarely in acute MR, in acute situation, pulmonary hypertension, heart failure can develop very early. Whereas organic regulatory valve disease with the band, actually, you can have a significant early and out of proportion CHF can be there. Rutenbacher, it can be there. RSOV is one condition where a left heart condition actually can present to you with clinical signs of right heart failure. And obviously, EMF and CCP, we all know that somebody comes with right heart symptoms predominantly, we immediately think of EMF and CCP. But these are the left heart condition you should think of in a patient presenting with out of proportion heart failure in a valve disease. So coming to the next factor, that is a precipitating factor. These are the common precipitating factors described in one of the study for heart failure in per se. I think in addition to that, RF recurrences, infective endocarditis, anemia should be added to these things. So how do you diagnose rheumatic fever recurrences with the criteria we should know? And the clinical diagnosis of rheumatic carditis, the endocarditis is manifested by an apical systolic murmur, Caricum's murmur, and aortic regurgitation murmur. Myocarditis generally is disproportionate tachycardia, cardiomegaly, and gallop and heart failure. Pericarditis is with rub and effusion. But let me tell you, very, very rarely gallop and cardiomegaly happens in the absence of a significant mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation. Now the studies have clearly shown by histopathology, by MRI, by PET, the occurrence of typical myocarditis in the ventricular myocardium is quite uncommon in myocardial, in rheumatic carditis, and most of the LV dysfunction that sets in myocarditis recovers once you have a valve fixed. Once the valve is repaired or replaced, the LV dysfunction rapidly improves. So the three important clues in a presence of a multivalve heart disease that can identify rheumatic carditis is subcutaneous nodules, erythema marginatum is also there, but we rarely find them. Presence of a rub and presence of a new murmur. That means new murmur is very difficult to identify in a given patient because we have not auscultated him before, we have not documented it before. So the only clue that can help you is presence of a subcutaneous nodule and rub. The last part of my talk will be on hemodynamics from clinical examination. How do you assess hemodynamics from clinical examination in a multivalve heart disease? So you practice a bit. I think you can actually make it out easily. So JVP is something that always any right side condition you should be reflected in JVP. Whereas BP and blood pressure and pulse should be the most important sign about left side. And in your language, JVP tweets about the right side, the modern era language, and the pulse and the BP are the Facebook of the left side. Whereas actually RSOV and ASD, the presence of RSOV and ASD actually are actually the additional likes for the examiners and the dislikes for the examiners. So going to the hemodynamics, you should all know what is the normal pressures and what are the permissible gradients. I think this is something that you should all know. What is the normal pressures in each chamber and what are the permissible gradient at each valve at each level. So, paracetamol lift due to pH indicates pulmonary artery systolic pressure is greater than 50 or significant stenosis in case of pulmonary stenosis. Epicocardiotic delay is a very high sensitivity and high specific for predictive accuracy for significant severe stenosis. Pulses alternate generally indicates ejection fraction of less than 30. And signs of PH, I already enumerated. Then you assess about PVH and you assess about PH. So you start from JVP. What is the height of JVP? You add 5 centimeters to it. The centimeter of water has to be converted into millimeter of Hg. 1.36 centimeter of water is equal to 1 millimeter of Hg. Okay, so you have to convert it to millimeter of Hg. So you look at various assessment of PA pressure, and then from PVH assessment, from pulmonary edema, other things that I have told, and so from this actually you can make up your mind about RA pressure, pulmonary venous pressure, pulmonary arterial pressure, and blood pressure, and based on other valve gradients, actually you start writing all the pressures. You can roughly get a hemodynamic of all the pressures. And most importantly, you will get a very good understanding of hemodynamics. Like, so one thing I told about the PVH assessment, I think I told you to look back at PA pressure estimation and the JVP estimation. So oftentimes I find in the examination, not oftentimes, a few times I found in the examination, patient, somebody presents it like severe MR, mild PVH, but severe PH with heart failure. So that is not going to happen, because the primary cause of PH is the PVH. So PVH has to be significant. So if there is even moderate PH, if you look at the numbers, there has to be some element of PVH has to be there, even if the patient is functional class 1. So you have to put the numbers together. Then the LA pressure generally has to be reflective of the RA pressure. JVP is a true reflection of RA pressure also. So in the nutshell, the take-home messages are: diagnosis of severity of valve lesion by clinical examination is very interesting and an educative exercise, but do not over-diagnose. Specifically specify mild and significant lesions. It is practiced to keep the art of our bedside teaching alive and used for undergraduate and postgraduate examination in the mind. Echocardiography and Doppler evaluation is the gold standard, but has clinical examination just been relegated to be a screening tool? I don't think so, because there is so much to synthesize and so much to learn and so much you can do. So the pressure and moral boost that you get in clinical examination, predict the echocardiography and Doppler finding, is actually immense. So I think it's very important. Multivalve lesion is like a Mona Lisa smile. I think my talk would have tried to demystify the smile. Thank you. So should we have the post CME folds now, sir?
Yeah. We will be posting the post session questionnaire. Total of 60 seconds to 90 seconds will be given for all the questions. We would appreciate if the audience can answer those questions, the participants.
Nobody is answering. Are they gone to sleep or the system is not working?
I think they can answer it. They can unmute and answer it, right, Bhupati, Dr. Bhupati? Or you want them to answer by chat?
They can. Only working. Yeah, one second. Let me check again.
Yeah. I think they answered it.
Yeah, they have answered. So they are awake.
Yeah.
No, it's an excellent talk, sir. I mean, I don't think anybody would have gone to sleep.
Yes, sir.
You are, I mean, even
the
though
we part, are, would have made everyone the analysis of getting all the details from clinical examinations.
I think so.
None of us went to sleep. Actually, we are in a trance. Beautiful.
No, after a real long time, I am hearing a complete analysis of clinical evaluation of rheumatic heart disease. He has almost covered everything. There's nothing we should look. He has started with a history, Jones criteria, PSRA, arthritis, current statistics, and history taking, everything. There's nothing we can look for. And individually, all the valves, individual valves, and then combined together in the hemodynamics. And I think it's a great clinical evaluation.
Upati, one more thing before we start the discussion, you can share the slides. I don't mind if you share the slides to the students. Like,
would you like to discuss the answers, sir?
Yeah, I think the answers are quite obvious. I think now we can discuss the answers. Like, are any other questions? Are like, for example, this one is like, it's quite obvious. Actually, it's inversely proportional. Like, a painful arthritis generally is not associated with severe carditis. Like, it's actually considered to be inversely associated. Like. So definitely severity of arthritis is quite an important risk factor, and presence of heart failure during first episode is an important risk factor, and clinical recurrence are very important risk factors. Next one.
Yeah.
I think they all have got it right. So I think maybe I think Ravi can add about the echo versus this thing like.
Well, no, echo, not in the acute carditis. I think we had done the study with Madam Saxena in the chronic RSDH. The
chronic RSDH, okay.
Yeah, yeah. So that was the rheumatic study, I think. But no, acute, I think still this one only, I think 70-80% still holds good.
Okay.
I don't know whether we have a data for echo in acute rheumatic carditis.
I think it is there, but I not referred actually. It's there. I think clearly it's there. I think we can go and refer. Actually, it's quite a, okay. even a, there's a meta-analysis also is now published. Systematic reviews also published by Carapetis and Circulation of just acute in acute carditis in echo in acute carditis.
Okay. Okay. Fine, sir. Yeah, let's go ahead.
Next one. So this, I think, is yes, your paper, Jayadeva's paper. Like, this is something that it repeatedly asked, like, which is more common, which is this. I think you should all read that paper and forget it. Like, that's it.
Yeah, that's the best paper in this regard, actually. Yeah. And the most contemporary also.
Yeah, most contemporary. Like, as I told you, like, I gave us some few important papers to read. I think they are very, very important papers. Nobody should go to the examination without reading those papers. It won't take more than 3 hours to read all the papers put together. Next one. So this again is actually quite a long lasting. Generally, it can last up to 8 months compared to acute rheumatic fever, which rarely goes beyond 6 weeks.
Would you recommend penicillin prophylaxis, sir, for maybe a year or so in this scenario?
Yeah, I think so. Now, even the guidelines now recommend penicillin prophylaxis, because even though some studies have said they 6%, but echocardiography studies now are saying even up till around 15-20% can develop chronic RSC lesions.
Yep.
So I think it's recommended now.
Correct.
Next. So this again, I told you, like, clearly atrial fibrillation is a more of a factor of age than severity of MS per se. So it's a relative thing. It's not an absolute thing. So in a 16-year-old with a MS as atrial fibrillation, definitely MS has to be severe.
Will be severe, yes.
It will be severe. So it's not that, that it's a kind of a relative thing.
Shall we discuss that part about pre-systolic accentuation, whether it is
there?
We
can discuss that.
So, I mean, if you ask me, I think it is there in AF.
Yeah, it is.
I have seen a few cases, surely. I mean, although there are opponents of this, there are proponents that it is there. I think the paper that was there was in NEGM, I think by Kelly, I think. It's Kelly's paper in 1976. And they suggested that it's the orifice, the mitral orifice tends to narrow as the gradient keeps increasing. As a result of which, there is at least a persistence of the murmur till the end diastole. I feel accentuation also will be there, but I'll accept if you can just accept that there's persistence of the murmur till the end diastole, I think that's fine.
There's another school of thought about the cycle length of the heart rate. Sometimes, because whenever the heart rate changes, especially in short cycle AF, as compared to long cycle AF, there can be a gradient that can be felt during the large end phase of the diastole, which was not here during the long cycle rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can get some opinion from Dr. Murthy. So, what should the students say? Like,
yeah,
I think that's the major thing where they get caught between long cycle and the short cycle.
Yes, sir.
And invariably, they try to escape because their cell left atrium is large and we could not pick it up.
But there are, I wouldn't say old timers, but those who stick to the, those who believe in the old teaching that AF doesn't have pre-systolic accentuation, there is that school of thought as well. So the examiners will have to, the examinees will have to be a little smart when they answer that question.
It may be there. The best answer will be maybe there in some patients. That's all.
That's better.
Because I think we should not penalize the student for that if he says so. Definitely.
Yeah, we should not. But that paper of NEJM nicely shows that persistence of the gradient very nicely, phonocardiographic and hemodynamic, both were there.
Jules Constant often quotes that. Jules Constant is books on clinical examination.
Yeah, yes. That is true, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
So next is the juvenile MS. I think it's very clearly, I told, no calcification, no thromboembolism, and no atrial fibrillation. Very, very few have atrial fibrillation.
Even though, and the definition is 20 years, right, sir? I think
20 years, the original paper is 20 years.
Some have taken 18 years also as a criteria.
I think 18 years also, and some pediatric PTMC papers have come from 15 and 12 also. People have published less than 12 years also.
But the original was 20 years.
Original description is 20.
Correct, yes.
What is the youngest patient with rheumatic fever you have seen in your experience?
In my experience, is around 5 years or so. But people have said it's almost 3 years. I think people have published, I think.
Yeah, the PTMC done was 4 years. I think the youngest PTMC done for MS was 4 years from, I think, SGPGI.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think actually I know Gujarat, somebody from Gujarat has done a PTMC where he doesn't do a PTMC, has done it in a less than 4 years.
Oh, okay.
He has not published it. Like.
Okay. Now this was published. So this was...
We tried in a 5-year-old and we had a lot of difficulty in getting it through.
Oh, yeah, it's terrible. It's very difficult. Terrible. Yeah.
The second I have explained in my talk, like I think rest of the things can be there because of other conditions. So wide split S2, if you are getting in a presence of MR where you are struggling to identify the severity of MR in a multiple heart disease, it always indicates severe MR. Because MR severity assessment is the biggest problem in a multiple heart disease. Because AS, AR and MS, you can pretty reasonably securely say what is the severity. But MR assessment is generally difficult. At times, it can be really difficult.
It's really difficult.
So this again, I have to told in the thing, which is a better heart in the heart on the right side. So bicuspid aortic with severe predominant AR still is generally heard on the left side only, despite having androaortic ectasia. So I think this again, I've explained the thing which has early onset right side heart failure, Luttenbacher because of AST. This I think is the most answered and the most rightly answered question, I think.
Yeah. Because it decompenses, the LA decompenses into the RA, and then so early onset of right heart failure.
Sir, what is the difference between Luttenbacher physiology and Luttenbacher syndrome for the benefit of the participants?
I think this is not so stringent like Eisenmenger physiology and Eisenmenger syndrome. People have tried to differentiate, but I think modern examination should move away from all this. Like, these are all terminology differences. People keep on asking. Like, I think Luttenbacher syndrome is one where there is absolutely no consensus whether to include MS MR with ASD or mild MS mild MR with ASD as Luttenbacher. So all those confusions are there, but I think by general thing is I think better to stick to any AS, any MS, any significant MS, any MR with ASD as Luttenbacher syndrome.
Yeah. And that's one of the conditions where you get a thrill at the base of the heart. I think there are only three conditions. So. Okay, go ahead, sir. Go ahead. Dr. Bhupati, you had
you had something else in mind? You had something else in mind?
No, sir.
The another question that always they ask in Luttenbacher is, would you do a device for Luttenbacher? Device and a PTMC. Sometimes, if you have this case, then that's going to be one tricky question.
So I ask another question like, how many of you think that doing a PTMC is easier in Luttenbacher compared to, because ASD is there, you don't have to do a septal puncture. Is it easy or difficult? Anybody, any volunteer can answer. Any student volunteer can answer. because you have a ASD, you don't have to. Why difficult? Dr. Anup has answered.
Yeah, very good.
And you can unmute yourself and answer why it's difficult.
No, not location.
Anything else? Anybody wants to answer this? It actually is technically very, very difficult.
Yeah.
It is oftentimes it.
Yeah, so because the there's no hinge of the septum. When you do a PTMC in an intact IAS, the septum serves as a hinge for your balloon to move. So the you're right, Dr. Om Prakash. There's no stability of the balloon.
When the dilatation happens, and then once you dilate the black dilator, whenever you make the hole a big, slightly bigger, immediately the balloon pops out. That is when the balloon pops out. So rest of the time it never pops out. Repeatedly the balloon will pop out if there is an ASD.
Correct. Yeah.
So you have to use some other technique or some other methods to enter the LV. LV entry becomes extremely difficult. But you can do. But lot of caveats are there, like whether you should do in one setting, whether you should wait for the results of PTMC. If the valve is open nicely, then you can go out and do a device. It also depends on the anatomy of the ASD. So if the anatomy of the ASD is suitable, then definitely it can be done. If the valve is suitable for PTMC, it can be done. But then the question will come, how do you do if there is a recurrence, restenosis?
There is a recurrence, yes. That is the biggest question.
You have any experience, both of you, doing in rotavirus ASD as well as the mitral valve?
Yes, so I have done total of 3 patients total till now. But over time, things have become easier now. Initial first case, we actually did it in 3 stages. Because we thought we didn't have a very great result because we found it extremely difficult. She was one of those 80% cardiomegaly patient, class 4 patient, ASD with MS in grass heart failure. And after almost 2 hours of struggle, we entered the LV and dilated the valve. But we didn't think that actually we did a good job, whether we have done the good job or not. So but the patient settled down nicely. So we waited for some time. We made sure that the valve remains open for six months or so. Then till the time the valve was open. Otherwise, we thought we'll again dilate once more and then put the device. So after that, once it was okay, there is nothing much happened. Then we went ahead and did a ASD device. I think that was one of the most easiest 20 plus device that I have put in, because it was only I put a 24 device in that patient. But that septum was almost 10 centimeter. So it was a cakewalk. Putting a 24 device was a cakewalk.
Okay.
So it was quite huge. It was unusually huge. But rest of the patients are usual, one was not so tight MS with the ASD. Other one was tight MS with the ASD. So all the 3 were okay.
So we use the over the wire technique where we put our coil wire directly into the LV. And then take the PTMC balloon over the wire into the LV.
Last few cases we followed, but that was the first case I'm telling is quite some time back where we didn't have the routine of putting over the wire.
I have only one case, so I don't, and I have not done a device for an AS, for that ASD. So this is only in class 4, I think. We only think of all this in class 4, really sick people where surgery would be a high risk. In that cases, yes.
But the other thing is, I have seen patient post PTMC developing ASD because the balloon was across the septum. So 2 cases we have seen in the last 15 years where the patient developed a iatrogenic ASD, not just the interatrial shunt, a significant atrial septal defect because the balloon opened the septum, where the PTMC balloon was inadvertently across the septum. So I have to go for it. One patient went for surgery, other patient. We are waiting on medicine. We could not see a follow up. One patient for surgery.
Right.
So some other people have asked some questions. Like one question is, cardiac percussion can be done in the presence of AF. I think it can be done, but I think generally the role of percussion has come down.
Yeah.
So nowadays in our examination pattern, if the student doesn't describe percussion, we are okay with it. In a case that doesn't require percussion.
I fully agree with you, sir. I think the time has come where if the student doesn't do percussion, we should not again penalize for that. We don't get great information most of our time. We have to accept that.
Except in congenital heart disease. Congenital heart disease, sometimes, many times they forget about it also then.
So I think that is a crucial thing that they cannot miss it in, for example, liver span, liver and the situs and all those things they have to do. That they cannot miss. So another question is how to take blood pressure in atrial fibrillation. So there are actually, you can refer back and there are good studies on it, that because it's a common problem of the West. So there'll be a lot of studies. They have actually shown that the typical way in which oscillometric methods take blood pressure, that same way you can follow, like the three times you can take with the in between time off, and then you can use the average of two. If the two first two are concurrent, you can stop at two also. That's good enough. There are studies on this. Actually, I've looked at blood pressure measurement in AF with oscillometric methods. Cool. You can follow what we are routinely following.
Pritham, last question.
Yeah, we'll finish the last.
So, enlighten the recent protocol of penicillin prophylaxis in RHD.
So maybe we can complete these the questions and then go for your questions.
Yeah, okay.
We'll finish this part and then I think.
I think this is the last question. So, I think we can. Which are the following clinical signs? I told you, like subcutaneous nodule, rub, and new murmur are the important clinical signs of recurrence of activity in a patient with chronic RST. So subcutaneous nodule will be the answer here.
Would you like to enlighten about the recent protocol of penicillin prophylaxis in rheumatic heart disease, sir?
I think, is there anything recent changes there? I am not aware. Like, are you aware of any, sir, any new recent changes there?
No, it is not that I am aware of, sir. Thing is still the same.
Standard, I don't know what recent, anything is, anything, he was asked anything, have you in mind, or are you just...
Dr. Harish, you had anything in mind when you asked that question, Dr. Harish?
Whatever I was aware of was the WHO had the same protocol, but the Australian government for their aborigines, they had some slight changes, sir.
They have been same when I did my MBBS.
Okay. It's still injectable and we prefer 3 weeks, right, sir?
Yeah, 3 weekly and 2 weekly whenever we are giving the lower dose in children.
6 lakhs. That is less than 27 kilos or 30 kilos.
27 kilos.
27 kilos.
27.
That is it. What to follow for profile, that's it.
Participants, if you have any other questions, please ask. It's a great time to ask the questions. Four of the senior professors there, they will be able to clear your doubts.
Status of penicillin prophylaxis after valve replacement.
So even if your DVR has been done, I think valve, generally it's recommended till 40 years of age at least, because of the, you have to protect the tricuspid valve involvement, right?
Yeah, at least 40 years, definitely. Yeah, some surgeons do it lifelong, but
lifelong.
Yeah, some, but mostly it's 40 years.
But recommendation now is for lifelong. I agree, but generally. Lifelong becomes an overkill in a DVR patient, I feel, personally.
Yeah. Now, often these post-DVR patients go to surgeons only, so they don't come back to us many times. So, the surgeons keep giving it. But that's okay. They have their own explanations for that. I'm fine if they want.
So how do you manage a patient with severe anaphylaxis with penicillin?
I haven't really seen
rheumatic heart disease.
I mean, I can assure you, we give almost 60 to 70 injections in Jayadeva per day. And it's been there for 60 to 70.
No, sir. I'm asking in case the patient is known to have an anaphylaxis.
So I'm telling you, I've not even seen one having a severe anaphylaxis in past 13 years, 12 years that I'm here. But yes, if it is there, then it's just, you put in an IV line, give Avilefcolin, give adrenaline if it is very bad.
Any other alternative oral regimen would you like to...
Later on, erythromycin. Okay. Later on, erythromycin, okay. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry, I didn't understand that part. You wanted later on.
But it's extraordinarily rare. That's what I wanted to say. I believe I heard a talk by KK sir, Krishna Kumar, that in Kerala they are sort of reluctant to give penicillins nowadays. I don't know if it's really true or not, but for us at least.
It's not available. I think in Tamil Nadu, Kerala, it is not available.
Oh, okay. But in Bangalore, it's available, sir. And,
now it's available again. Now it's available again.
Okay.
I have seen patient just dying within minutes. We want to have time also. One thing we recommend always is, if you want to give palliative prophylaxis, it is preferably given where there is a resuscitation available. That means adrenaline. Without immediate availability of adrenaline, you should not try. I have seen, interestingly, not in rheumatic prophylaxis, but it was given for syphilis.
Okay.
I was working in a STD department. Single shot, next minute, you are dead. So the anaphylaxis can be very, very, very catastrophic.
Right. No, so it's given in our hospital only, in hospital. So we are not giving it in any other place.
Someone has asked for the role of oral penicillin, sir.
So oral penicillin actually are definitely inferior to injectable penicillin by almost 3 to 5 fold. So generally, injectable penicillin is always preferable. There are good data on this, on recurrences, recurrence rate with various regimes. People can refer to that.
In fact, like the Ramakrishna said, the study students can quote is old one. As such, as you initially said, sir, not much of data. And the Irvington House study is the one we quote always. That is the 70s thing. Irvington House studies, which clearly said, as you rightly said, oral penicillin is far inferior to intramuscular.
One person has asked the risk of hematoma in a patient who's got on warfarin with the injection prophylaxis, sir.
I think can be given safely. I don't think there is a need to even check INRs.
We give it routinely. No issues on that. Azithromycin, I don't think we should. It's an overkill if you're going to keep giving azithromycin for prophylaxis. You're going to create resistance for it. So please don't use it. There's a question on azithromycin. And penicillin, I think we have pentids. We don't have K-pen. K-pen is not very easily available. So again, what's recommended is K-pen and not pentids. So that again is a problem. We have Adam people.
Has asked one more question, sir. Which one has got a worse prognosis with higher mortality? Acute MR or acute AR?
So, acute severe
MR versus acute severe AR, which one has got higher mortality?
Difficult question. Practically, we don't come across acute severe AR so often, except for dissection. Or maybe an endocarditis where the ruptured.
But the question is to understand the hemodynamics only. The question is focused on hemodynamic, like. So okay. I think it will be MR will be poorly tolerated generally.
MR, PTMC. You see when what happens with PTMC. You develop severe MR. True. What about the new the change in guidelines for prophylaxis of IE, sir? What are your opinions? You guys prefer
I think most of the prophylaxis were given previously for dental procedures only, mostly. Mm-hmm. So our dental procedures are totally different from Western dental procedures by and large. At least the patient that we see in AIMS and in Jayadeva. So what I mean is that most of the times our patients go to a dentist. Mm-hmm. When they have a dental caries, when they have to do an extraction, when they have to do a filling. So, invariably in India, dental practice is always associated with prescription of oral antibiotics. Very rarely you will go to a dentist and get a dental extraction done, where you will not be given prescribed antibiotics. Then our dental prophylaxis is a matter of dosing and pre-procedure whether to give or not. So, anyway, the patient is going to get a dose of oral antibiotics, it's always better to give. In our patients. Another argument is the reason why they change the prophylactic rule is because some other situations where they did not recommend prophylaxis, they felt the IE prognosis is better. IE's prognosis is good. Anyway, our IE prognosis is very bad. Look at Indian IE prognosis is anyway bad, so we don't qualify for that exemption. So I think we may still continue if somebody comes to, because our IE outcomes are terribly bad.
Our IE, yes. Yeah, so we also continue giving it the same. And there are, of course, apart from the European and the American, there is the Australian guidelines. Australian guidelines still prescribe IE prophylaxis for rheumatic heart disease. Same with Brazilian, same with South African guidelines. So it's not just the end of the world that just because Americans and Europeans have said no, we stop it. And as sir has rightly said, the prognosis of IE in India is extremely bad. And so it's better to prescribe prophylaxis for rheumatic heart disease IE. And lastly, of course, is that there are studies of late which have shown that incidence of IE has increased in some of these Western countries where the guidelines changed. So that also has to be kept in mind that IE incidence has slowly started increasing in the West after they have stopped. There's a question of why you 21 days and not 28 days. Why do you give it for 21 days of injection? I think it's because the penicillin levels start to taper off at 21 days, and by 20, that's the answer, right, sir? I mean,
there are studies. Sorry, sir. Please.
Hey, go ahead.
No, sir, please, sir. So, no.
Go ahead.
No, sir, no way, sir. Please.
No, like there are studies that compared 3-weekly versus 4-weekly regimen suggesting that there could be some improvement. But as Dr. Muralidharan sir and Murthy sir pointed out, they're all pretty old time studies, and actually we need to replicate those studies too with echocardiographic background. That's the most important thing. Actually, if you look at the evidence base for all these prophylaxis, is actually pretty weak in current evidence-based practice. So one of the most commonly prescribed thing that is actually not evidence-based in cardiology will be this one. In terms of evidence base, it's actually not on a very significant evidence base.
Right. Another study that people can also read up is the Euro Heart Survey 2. Rama sir had shown was of Euro Heart Survey 1. 2018, the Euro Heart Survey 2 also came out. So that also they can read. And of course, the remedy study is very important because that's contemporary for the developing world. Euro Heart 2 is for the Western population.
So somebody has asked about how to comment on the first questions in clinical presentation. Maybe they all understood everything. So rest of them are in prophylaxis and IE. So the first question in clinical cardiology. So somebody has asked what to comment on severity of any valve lesion in presence of AF and how to. I think it is fairly simple. The most important change is going to happen in the long cycle and short cycles. So you have to concentrate on the individual lesions. And it's not difficult. Most of the other signs will remain like. So how do you look for epicocaryotic delay and quantify? I think actually epicocaryotic delay is normally there. If you look at normally, it is always there. If it is more than, it's generally not appreciable level, like because the difference is then, up to 60 millisecond is not, maybe you can refer, I'm not exactly sure how much, is, maybe sir can add on that. Some 60 millisecond is normal, beyond that is abnormal. Yeah. So I think normally apical carotid delay is there. I just palpate the apex and feel the carotid. Yeah. 40 millisecond, somebody's answer is 40 millisecond. So severity look in long cycles or short cycles. This is mostly related to mitral stenosis murmur. So generally, you are supposed to look at in long cycles.
Long cycles. Yeah. So if your murmur persists in the long cycle, then it is significant. In short cycle, even for mild to moderate MS, you may have a pan diastolic murmur or a whole diastolic murmur.
The problem happens only in diastolic events like MS and AR. So rest of them are generally okay. Where I think the ejection may actually pose a problem. But if you find severity in the beat with the best cardiac output, still you should be able to make it. The diastolic events are the one which causes more confusion. Where AR will definitely be given, peripheral signs will help you. MS is the only one where actually at times you find it difficult to assess severity of MS in terms of AF with fast ventricular rate primarily. In the presence of multiple lesions, suppose there is MR also, there is this also, but individual lesion, if there is MS, then this should not be a big difficulty.
Don't have any other questions. Would you like to thank the operator, I mean the speaker, Dr. Professor Ramakrishnan sir, the moderators, Professor Murthy sir, and Dr. Ravi Math, who have spent their valuable time in educating the students. We will be thankful to the management of Sri Ramachandra and all the esteemed faculties of Ramachandra Cardiology Department. And especially to our head of the department, Dr. Muralidharan sir. So this is the beginning of a new virtual program. So this is a schedule. I hope you can see my screen. This is the schedule that we are planning to have for the next couple of weeks in this month. So for the next one, what we will be having after next coming Tuesday, which will be a virtual case presentation from JIPMER. Stop others. There's a virtual case presentation from JIPMER. Dr. Nikhil Motiramani from JIPMER will be presenting. And the honorable examiners will be Dr. Nitish Nayak from All India Institute of Medical Sciences and Dr. Santosh Sadish from JIPMER. This is a new norm for most of the medical school colleges in our country. So I would appreciate, I would request all the participants, especially the exam going postgraduates, to utilize the same. Thank you, one and all. We will meet you again on coming Tuesday, July 21st at 10 a.m. between 10 a.m. and 12 noon. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Murthy.
Thank you very much, Professor Ramakrishnan and Ravi.
Dr. Murthy.
And thank you, sir. It's a pleasure to meet you all.
Thank you, sir.
Let me finish with this.
My pleasure.